right kind of discomfort actually produces good in our lives. It's often the process that we have a problem with. Yes, we want deliverance, but we don't necessarily love the process. That is the piece that is problematic for us. See, sometimes the struggle that we're going through is not for us, but it's someone coming behind us. And the best people to help you overcome are the people who have already been through it themselves. Moses told the people, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. That's the word for us this weekend.
Past 3 weeks, we've talked about creation, we've talked about promise, and then last week we talked about the Exodus. And Pastor Josh, he exhorted us with the words of Moses to wait on God, for the day of salvation is coming. The day of salvation is here. And so today I want to talk about a theme that will set up the coming themes in the coming weeks. And the theme is this: it's covenant. We're going to talk about the covenant today. Now, if you've been through premarital discussions with our pastoral team, you know that we will often talk about the difference between a contract and a covenant. And we see that in culture, these words are often used interchangeably, but we know there's very different meanings to these two different words. One is an exchange and the other is a commitment. Now, how many of us here over the past year have been to a wedding ceremony? Let me see those hands. How many weddings? All right. A lot of us have. And I think most of us probably have been to one over our lifetime. And last statistics I saw that was D.C. was the second most expensive city in America to get married. And so I'm guessing for those hands that went up, like, it wasn't in D.C., was it? Was it out of town? Like, unless we got, like, those kinds of friends. But it's funny. We live here, but we can't afford to actually get married in our own city, right? I've done about 25 or 30 weddings. And I think a wedding is one of the most beautiful, meaningful events that we have in our culture. I like to think that's because of my sermon. Right, and I'm just flowing and waxing on, but it's really not because of my sermon, because I get to the end of my sermon and then I see people kind of perk up. Oh, here we go. All right, now we're ready, and they get kind of on the edge of their seats. Oh, the vows! It's the vows. Here we go, and it's because people are anticipating this romantic moment. They're wondering if that person who never shows emotion will suddenly crack and break. And you, why? Oh, is he gonna do it? And or maybe the person who always shows too much emotion, like, are they gonna go overboard this time? Are they gonna outdo themselves? And so you get to this moment, and then, you know, the groomsman or the best man always does that obligatory joke where we want the ring, and he does the thing, and oh, I don't. Oh, ah, gotcha, gotcha. And I give him the old, oh, yeah, really original, right? Okay. And then we go and they turn, and now you need to turn and face one another. And they turn and face one another, and they begin to go into the vows right there. And at this moment, they don't use contractual language. They use covenantal language. Now, there's a reason that I don't invite you to be a part of the contractual signing of my iPhone. Because it's boring, right? I mean, it's a functional 2-year agreement that I am making. It's a business transaction. But can you imagine in the ceremony if at this moment they turn and face one another and then they start to talk contract terms? Could you imagine this? Like, well, I'll get married if you agree to do the dishes every day. Well, I'll get married if you agree, like, that you'll make at least $50,000 a year. Well, I'll agree if you promise not to let yourself go after 5 years. Whoa, 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 whoa. Now, hey, we'd all be in trouble there. And what if they went into this contractual? What would we do as onlookers? We'd be like, man, this is a ripoff. This isn't a marriage ceremony. This is an iPhone contract. That's what we're watching. A marriage is not a covenant. A marriage is not a contract. Oh, boy. I'm about to get it. I'm about to get it. Where's Nina? All right. Marriage is not a contract. It's a covenant. It's an all-in, give-my-whole-life proposition, not just try it out. I read this article. It was an article on where Mexico City has actually, they've studied this plan to potentially introduce this idea of temporary marriage licenses. So after 2 years, you can just allow it to dissolve and split, or you can decide to renew your marriage license. So here's what the assemblyman said, who co-authored the bill, Linnell Luna. And I'm hearing some feedback. I don't know if you're like, that's crazy, or that's a good idea. I don't know what your feedback is right now, but I'm not going to ask. Says this, the proposal is when the 2-year period is up, if the relationship is not stable or harmonious, the contract simply ends. So it's literally redefining covenant as a contract, avoidable agreement that is dissolved if the two parties don't like its course. Covenant is not practiced when you feel like it. It is not easy. It's not suitable. Covenant is quite the opposite, is it not? It's a commitment. It's hard. It's relational. Today I want to outline the basis, the result, the beauty, and the fulfillment of biblical covenant. So first we'll start with the basis of covenant. The basis of covenant is promise. Exodus chapter 6, verses 5 through 8 says this, Moreover, I have heard the groanings of the Israelites, whom the Egyptians are enslaving. I have remembered my covenant. Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. If you were to attend a Jewish Seder, you would go in and you would see 5 cups on the table. These cups are filled with wine. And the host would implore you to pick up the first cup of wine and to drink it, to honor this first idea, to honor that God has brought us out. And then you take the second cup of wine and you drink it and you honor that God has delivered you from bondage. And then you pick up the third cup and you drink and you honor that God has redeemed you. And you pick up the fourth cup And it's this beautiful, it's all kind of wrapped into one in this beautiful statement at the very end in verse 6. It says, I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. These are four elements of the redemption that you drink in. You take them in, you ingest, and you actively participate and realize the redemption that is from God, that we are no longer slaves, that no bondage can hold us down, that freedom comes in God to live a new life on mission for God. Now, here's where we have to be careful, though, because in our American mindset, we can easily begin to start focusing on only the benefits of covenant relationship, right? We immediately go there and maybe we think, okay, what can I get out of this relationship? Maybe that's our mindset. And maybe you're here and you say, yeah, I think some people do that. But what if it's actually you that does that and you don't even realize it? Like, look at your prayers. When you pray to God, what's the content of your prayers? Is it all about what you need? Is it all about what you want from God? What about when you share God with others? What do you tell them? Is it, do you talk to them about what God will give them or what he can do for them? It's like a consumer mentality that we take in approaching God, but that's not what covenant relationship is. If you have a covenant friendship, you know that friendship is not about what you can extract from that other person. It's not about what you can get from that other person. That covenant friendship is about what you can invest, about what you can give to the other. But what approach do we take with God? The key, the milestone, the hallmark of covenant is verse 6. You are my people. That's the promise that God makes of committed love of covenant. Dr. Tim Keller, he talks about the effect of culture on our mindset, and he says this. He says, sociologists argue that in contemporary Western society, the marketplace has become so dominant that the consumer model increasingly characterizes most relationships that historically were covenantal. Today, we stay connected to people only as long as they are meeting our particular need at an acceptable cost to us. When we cease to make a profit, that is, when the relationship appears to require more love and affirmation from us than we are getting back, then we cut our losses and we drop the relationship. I'm getting a little ring up here. I don't know if you guys can hear that. It's just a little ting. Like, just quickly digest the contrast of contract versus covenant just a moment here. Let me just kind of shoot some statements at you. Contract is transactional. Covenant is relational. I love the definition. Covenant, an unconditional commitment to an imperfect person. Contract is dependent upon the terms. Covenant is regardless of the terms. Contracts involve assurances. Covenants involve oaths. There's a reason that we still, even in secular society, we still hold certain offices to make an oath, like military or police or doctors or public officials. We make them take an oath because our lives are in their hands, right? So we want them to promise before God that they are going to do the best that they can do in these different offices. In fact, if you go old school, back in the day, public offices used to swear on a Bible. They would take an oath and they would open it up to Deuteronomy chapter 28 and put their hand there, and it's where the blessings and the curses are. And so you take an oath before God and you know what's coming your way if you don't live up to that oath. It was a covenant in their position that these are high, important positions that have an effect. An oath still we hold high. This is covenant, not contract. Contracts exchange property. Covenants exchange people. Again, verse 6. God says, you will be my people. A holy nation, a royal priesthood. So the basis of covenant is the promise. And second, the result of covenant is protection. Our reading started in Exodus chapter 20 this week. And I assume everyone is caught up and fully engaged. And if you're not, you know what? That's okay. Grace be to you today. But I'll also say this, jump in. This is a wonderful way to enrich your walk with the Lord. And you can read on your own. And I think we've got the slide behind me. It's the website that you can go to get the reading plan if you're not joining us. But then we're talking about every single weekend, we're talking about what you're reading. So isn't this wonderful? You can enrich your walk with the Lord as you do this. So I encourage you to join us if you're not. But this week in Exodus chapter 20, we read there, and we see two kinds of benefits or covenantal protection, if you will. First, we see salvific protection, and then we see preemptive protection. And it starts in verse 1. And God spoke all these words, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. So this is salvation protection. But then preemptive protection comes right after that, and it's what we know as the Ten Commandments. So for time purposes, I'm going to just kind of read the phrases of the commandments and go through them quickly. Verse 3. You shall have no other gods before me. Verse 4, you shall not make for yourselves graven images. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet. Now, this is not God trying to be overbearing and make your life hard. This is a father trying to love his children and teach them how to live and lead their life. Now, my kids know that they are not allowed to cross the street without an adult. This is not me as a dad trying to be controlling, contrary to popular belief by three little people. This is not me trying to control. This is me trying to protect. Now, if they jump out or if they try to cross without, they know they're going to get discipline. But that discipline is for a reason. The discipline is given to protect my children. Now, do I discipline them because I don't love them or because I do love them? You hear what I'm saying today? And we take, when God is trying to help us learn discipline, we take that as just potential pain that we're going to have to go through. But it's quite the opposite. God is saying, no, I want discipline in your life so that you can steer clear of pain that might be in your path. Now, some of us have a hard time understanding the importance sometimes of expectations that God puts on us, in this instance, in the form of these commands. Well, that's just... I write them off as limitations. And if we can't see the benefit, if we can't understand the benefit of everything that we are called to do by God, then a lot of times we'll just shrug them off. We'll just set them aside and we'll go Jeffersonian on the scriptures, right? We'll just take what we like and the other stuff we'll kind of set aside. Can I just speak from some experience for just a moment? There are times that I see God's word and I know what I'm supposed to do, and I know that's right, and it's actually kind of easy, and I know the benefits that are going to come, so I do them. Now, there are also times where I see the words of Scripture and I know that's going to be hard to do, but I still understand the benefits, but it's going to be hard, and so I want to try to push through and obey. And then the third piece is this. There are times where God's word, or in relationship with Him, where I am called to do something that I can't understand what the benefit of that thing is. I don't get it. The question is, do I obey in number 3? Do we obey? There's a difference in a contract and a covenant. Do we trust God or do we use God? Do we just see Him as an advice giver? As a sage off to the side where we'll take what we like from what He says? Or do we truly live in covenantal relationship where we will put our faith and our trust in Him no matter what? A parent knows things that a child does not. And sometimes a child needs to trust that parent to fully live in the protective nature of that relationship. When I was a young man, my parents sat me down. And I was dating this girl, and they shared their concerns about her. and they shared the red flags and the different things that they thought, you know, weren't going to be great in our relationship and for us. And they shared these things in love, and you know, I got no problem with that, and that was fine. But can I let you in on a secret? They didn't get it. You know what I'm talking about? Anybody here have parents that didn't get it? Anybody here are parents who don't get it right now, right? You know what I'm talking about? My kids might have that refrain about me. I don't know. That maybe. And so they didn't get it. So I heard them, okay? And most of what they have to say in life was good. Most of it I agreed with. This one they shared, you know, I just couldn't understand what they were saying. And so I heard it, but I just said, no, that's not practical to me. And so I'm going to set that aside. 2 years later, I understood something. They got it. And I did not get it. And you know what? I got it. I got it good. I got it across the face. I got it on the back. I mean, I got, and it was pain. Pain was brought into my life, and hurt was brought in my life that was unnecessary. I did not have to go through that. If I would have gone and listened to, in a moment where my parents shared something with me, gave me not rules so much as words of wisdom to lead my life a certain way. If I would have gone back and in a moment where I didn't understand what they were talking about, but I was in a trust relationship with them, I set that trust aside. If I would have just trusted and listened to their guidance in that moment. Do you hear what I'm saying today? There are moments and there are things sometimes in the scriptures where you say, I appreciate you, God. But you know what? You don't quite get it here. And I don't understand where you're going with this, so I'm just not going to play that one out. Do we live in a trusting relationship with Almighty God? His covenant brings protection to our lives. So Moses and the people step into a covenant relationship with the Lord. Exodus 33:12, Moses said to the Lord, "You have been telling me, lead these people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me." Go down to verse 14. It says, "The Lord replied, 'My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest.'" The result of covenant is protection. But third, the beauty of covenant is presence. After Moses entered into the covenant, it says that he would go to the tent of meeting quite often. And Moses would go there, and he would just reside with God. And when he would go there, the scriptures say that a pillar of cloud would come down and would rest in the entrance way to the tent. And they would just be together. He would just spend time in prayer and getting to know God and listening to God and receiving that relationship. You know, the commands, these 10 commands and the commands of the scripture, they were the product of spending time with God. They weren't just random laws that were collected. They are a reflection of the character of God. Now, let me just set that aside for a moment and come at it from a different example. Okay, so if you grew up in my home, you knew that when you were in high school, that before school, that we would sit down and read and pray before we went about our day. This was a rule in our house that we would all do this as kids. And so my dad kind of made this rule, and we applied it. We lived by it. But here's the thing. Like, it wasn't just to get our brains working before school. But it also was a revelation of the character of my dad. And so, you know, we would sit down and do this, and we would step into prayer, and we would learn something about the character of somebody who was so disciplined and who held prayer in such high honor. And it was both an intimate rule, and it was an intimate experience with him. I wonder if you think about your parents, and maybe I wonder if you could think back and realize that a rule that they had actually was not just a rule, it was a revelation of their character. Think back for just a moment. What was that rule that revealed who they were and what they wanted to see in you and their character coming out? Okay, now take that idea. And now we step back into the scripture here. And now let's look at the commands once again. When he says, "No other gods," he is declaring his sovereignty. do not make a graven image, reveals his transcendence and his jealousy. Do not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, points to the use of his holiness. We see, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy, reminds us of God's rest and his creativity. Honor your father and your mother reminds us that God is community. We see this command, do not murder, reveals that God gives and he takes away, that he is the creator, he is the redeemer, he is the restorer, the sustainer of life, and he gives it in abundance to our lives. Do not commit adultery, it shows us the faithfulness of God. Do not steal, it points to his providence. Do not bear false witness, declares that God is truth. Do not covet, it points us to the sufficiency of God. And so we know this. We know that his commands are not just a set of do's and don'ts, but that God Almighty desires to step out and allow you into intimate rule and into intimate relationship and into an intimate experience and intimate love with he who's created you and desires to have covenant with you. This is our God. He pulls us in. And he puts himself, and these are the commands are a revelation of who God is. He sets a high bar because he wants you to live a high life, because he has a high standard for you, because he knows that you are bigger and better than those things below you. My coach used to say this. He used to say, man, if I stop coaching you, if I stop correcting you, that's when you should actually get worried. Because it means that I've given up on you. But every time I correct you, every time I get on you, every time I coach you, every time I make you go that extra sprint, every time I get up your business, it's me believing that you are better. It's me calling out what is good within you that you do not see, but I see it in you. It's me taking you up another level and to another notch in your existence. It's me helping you become who I know you are and who I know you can be. God's law reveals his love, and it also portrays his presence. Now, each law reveals a piece of God's heart. And we see this, and it creates this almost cyclical relationship of growth within our lives and all of our relationships. And when we look back at the commands, we see that there's kind of order to them. They form this general paradigm, a process of growth, if you will. And the first four commands are meant to work on our vertical relationship with God. And when we work on this, then it leads us to the fifth command, this command to honor those authorities that God has first given you, to honor your father and your mother. And it's almost a bridge, if you will. When we learn to honor our parents, and some of us had great parents, and some of us had not so great parents. There's a way to honor in both those instances. It doesn't mean you affirm or accept, but there's something about honoring those who have come before you. When we honor them, then it leads us into the horizontal relationship. And the last five commandments are all about loving our neighbor. What happens when you try to love your neighbor? You realize how much you need God. And it brings you back around. And so it's this beautiful cycle. When we serve God, then we honor, then we love our neighbor, then we come back and we realize we need God and we need to honor. And it's this beautiful cycle that God takes us into through his commands. It's the beauty that leads us to the presence both of God and of our neighbors. The fourth thing is this: the fulfillment of covenant is payment through Christ. The Hebrew word for covenant is the word bereth. Used 280 times in the scripture, and it comes from this root word. It's derived from the root word to cut. So it's a cutting process, and it's a reference back to the Old Testament ceremony of covenant, where both parties would cut an animal in half, and they would set them aside, and then both covenantal parties would walk through the middle of those animals, essentially saying this, that if we do not live up to this covenantal relationship, what happened to that animal, may it happen to us. This is big deal stuff. It's unique. It's different. There are consequences when we break covenant. There is payment that has to be made in when you step out in covenant and when you fail in covenant. There has to be a payment, but this is the beauty. This is our story. Because every one of us have fallen short of the glory of God. We have all sinned. We have all messed up. We have all failed. Every single one of us in this room, every single one of us has missed it. Yet God comes along and remains in covenant relationship with us, so loving that he takes what was dearest to him and sends his son into the earth. And Christ comes and he lives a perfect life. And he takes on the form of payment on him. And he takes on our failures on him. And he's cut. Right? His body is cut. What is supposed to be on our back when we walk through and we don't live up and we sin. Christ comes and he takes our cut and he takes our wrath on his back and receives it so that we might have relationship with Almighty God. So that we might be restored once again before the Lord. And we see it in Matthew 5:17. He says that I didn't come to destroy the law. I came to be a fulfillment of the law. And so Christ fulfills the law at Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that you may boast. So by grace, through faith, you are saved. God's grace is here today. Do you know that? If you take a simple step of faith, scriptures say you will be saved. Remember, I was talking earlier about the Passover Seder. And there's five cups, right? And I talked about the four that you drink. So you drink these four cups. But there's this last cup that remains on the table. And it sits there, and it's not drank. And it's called the cup of Elijah. And this cup, if you go back to Jeremiah 25 and Malachi 4, we see it talks about the cup of wrath. And so when you come to this moment with the fifth cup in the ceremony, the door is opened, and the head of the household says this. He says, pour out your wrath on the world. We find in Matthew chapter 26, Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. It's right before he's going to go to the cross. And he's praying, and here's what it says in verse 42. It says, he went away a second time and prayed, my Father, listen to this, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. Jesus drinks the fifth cup. He drinks the cup of wrath. He drinks our problems. He drinks our failures. He drinks our sins. He drinks our insufficiencies. He drinks our imperfections. And he drinks in so that we might pour out. And Jesus, we see in the scripture, he takes the disciples and he sits down with the disciples at the Last Supper. And we're just about to come to the Lord's table. And worship team, you can come. We're about to come and celebrate at the Lord's table. And he sits down at the Last Supper with the disciples. And most likely it was a Passover Seder. And he sits down, but here's the thing. He doesn't just go through this to teach the disciples. I wonder if he also went through it for himself. Because he was about to face the hardest decision and choice of his life. And so I wonder if he sits down here and he soaks in the presence of God and he soaks in this idea that we are delivered, that God has brought us out, that God has picked us up, that he has defeated the brokenness in our life, that he has delivered us, that he has redeemed, and that he is with us in all circumstances. And Jesus soaks this in and then he steps in to drink that cup of wrath, to take on that torture and that pain just for us. And he fulfills the covenant. And now we no longer go back and just reference the Old Testament Exodus coming out of Egypt. But now today, what do we live in? We live in a new covenant. The old covenant has been fulfilled and Christ has given us a new covenant so that we can stand up and step out and realize these promises and reinterpret them in a new way in our life. That we can know that God brings us out of a life of sin. That God brings us out and he takes us
to overcome and deliver us from our bondage, that he has redeemed us from all our faults and failures, and that God is making us his people, for we are his. Can I get an amen? Amen.